Ryan, welcome back to our Coldworking 101 video series. Today we're going to be talking about silicon carbide. Now you've probably watched some of our earlier videos where we talked about the differences in the different abrasives. You may even have seen one of our videos that talks about and shows the difference between using silicon carbide as a slurry grinder on a flat lap versus diamonds on a flat lap. Well, today we're going to talk about just hand lapping with silicon carbide. It's one of the easiest, least expensive ways to get cold working done in a very small area with very few materials and a very low budget. So it's a great way to start off with cold working. Gives you a tremendous amount of control over what you're doing. Now, if you have watched our previous videos, you'll know that silicon carbide is a very sharp abrasive. It's a very hard abrasive. It's about an 8 on the Mohs scale. Glass is going to be about 5 or 5.5 on the Mohs scale, so it's much harder than glass. Silicon carbide is very, very sharp as an abrasive, so it's going to take material off very quickly. You'll also may remember that silicon carbide is extremely friable, which means it's going to break down very quickly. So as you're using your silicon carbide to hand lap your pieces, if you start with like a 60 grit, which we'll start today, that's very, very aggressive. The longer you are on it, the faster it's going to break down and the finer and finer it will get. So you'll actually get from about a 60 grit grind up to almost what would be close to a 100 grit surface on it if you're on there long enough. So we're going to take a look today about the process of hand lapping with loose grit silicon carbide, how easy it is, how efficient it is on your glass, and it gives you another avenue to be able to work on things without having to do a whole lot of equipment. So let's dive in. So you'll see in front of me on my work table, I've got a piece of cardboard down to just catch any kind of loose materials that are going to be happening so I can keep my tabletop clean. I also have this large piece of plate glass. The thing that you need to remember when you're doing loose grit hand lapping is you'll want a nice flat surface to work on. A piece of plate glass, piece of float glass is perfect. It's going to be super nice and flat. As you work it, you will also be grinding the surface of your flat glass here. So eventually you'll need to replace it, but it's really inexpensive material to use. Then you can always repurpose it for something else around the shop that you need. So we're going to show you starting off today working with a 60 grit silicon carbide, a 220 grit silicon carbide, and a 400 grit silicon carbide. And we're going to move through all those steps. Now the piece I'm going to be working on today is a piece that's going to go through a couple of different iterations here in the shop. Right now it's been glued once with Hextol. I've got two pieces of glass here. This is a lead crystal chunk and a borosilicate crystal chunk. My borosilicate part here has the texture on it from when it was made at the factory. So I want to try and remove this texture, get this down to a flat surface so I can get it up to a polish, and then I can bond it with another piece of glass later on. And so today, we're going to use silicon carbide hand lapping to do that. And I'm going to start off with my 60 grit. So I'm going to move my 400 and 220 out of the way. And we're going to take a look at our 60 grit. So our 60 grit silicon carbide, if you look closely at that, it's very, very granular. It's very, very abrasive. And I probably put way too much on here already. It does not take a whole lot of silicon carbide to do hand lapping. And you can see I've got a large piece of plate glass here. I'm going to use two different sides of it. Use my 60 grit on this side, my 220 on this side. Once we're done, I'm just going to flip this over and use my 400 on the back side. So you can use different areas of a piece of plate glass, different sides of it, just depending on how many steps you're going to do with your hand lapping. Or even if you're only doing one step, you can continue using multiple places on your float glass. So it can really last you quite a long time if you're going to do hand lapping. So the first thing we want to do is add a little bit of water to our silicon carbide. We want it to be a slurry. Just like we have a slurry on our flat lap, you want it to be a slurry on our plate glass here as well. Now, when you get down to finer grits, you can actually add like a couple of drops of dishwashing liquid to it. It helps break the surface tension. It'll keep those finer grits from clumping up quite as much. Rougher grits, not as much of a problem. You could always throw some dishwashing detergent in here, just a couple of drops just to break that surface tension, but this should work really well. Now, if you've watched our previous video on slurry grinding on the flat lap, you'll remember on our diamond lap, we have a very controlled movement. On our slurry lap, we kind of moved around a little bit. That's exactly what we're going to do here. We want to try and keep this loose abrasive underneath our piece of glass so we get fresh abrasive working against all the time. Now, the easiest way to do that is just trying to make a figure eight movement on my piece of glass with my silicon carbide. So let's show you how this works. So you can see my 60 grit silicon carbide here, my textured piece of glass. So we're gonna start off and just make my little figure eight movement, giving some downward pressure. Change direction on it. Get some of your grit back under it. It's a great little thing to do if you've got some extra time. It can be very relaxing. Stick some headphones in, listen to a podcast, and just grind away. Now you can see I'm also changing the way I'm holding my piece every so often, just because I'm putting a lot of pressure down on one area and I want to try and keep this as flat as I can. So I'm going to change the direction every once in a while just to make sure that I'm giving an even grind on my piece. And you may be able to see it's already going through this pretty quickly. Now, it's not as fast as diamond grinding, for sure. It is hand lapping with a loose abrasive. I'm getting closer and closer. And as this wears, it's going to break down and give me a little bit finer, a little bit finer. So you can see I'm not really adding any more abrasive to this because I do want it to break down a little bit. Let's wash this off and take a look at it. So we've washed and dried this off, and you can see already on a very short amount of time I've got a nice flat surface here. All my texture is gone from the glass, and it really didn't take too long. You've got a nice little randomized grind pattern on here, just like if it were sandblasted almost. And that's how quick and easy loose grit grinding can be. So let's jump over to our 220 grit and see how we can go a little bit further on this. So the easiest way to do that when you're loose grit grinding to see how you're going is just get like a really fat magic marker. And we're gonna color in our surface here. And this is gonna be a real easy way for me to see if I'm grinding past the deeper areas of this 60 grit on my next layer. Without checking it a whole lot. So we'll switch over our grits, let that dry off for a minute, and come back. So I've just switched my piece of plate glass here. You can probably still see my 60 grit over here on this side. And you can leave this on there. It's gonna dry back out, but you've got a grit on there. And if you're gonna do this more often, don't clean it up, just leave it on there. You can always add a little bit more grit to it, but you've already got some on there. You can cover it over with a little bit of plastic wrap if you don't want it blowing away or getting it into everything once it dries out, but no need to clean it off every time. So now we're gonna move to our 220 grit. And you can see a big difference in how the 60 and the 220 looks. So it's still a little granular, but it's gonna stick to me a little bit more. The particles are a lot finer. Here's where I probably would put a little dish soap in here, but I don't really have any right now. So I'm just gonna mix in some water, and you can see how it's wanting to clump up already in that 220 grit. Our 400 grit, when we move to it, it's gonna be even worse. So putting a little bit of dish soap in there, a couple of drops, really helps prevent that from clumping up so badly when you're working with it. And here I've got my piece. I've drawn my magic marker on there. It's dried now. So let's see how this works. I have a little bit too much water, but that's all right. Probably see through the top here, a lot of my magic marker's gone. So that's doing a really good job so far, going very, very quickly. I'm just gonna go a little bit further just to make sure I get enough of this done. Like with anything else, your rough grind step is gonna be probably your longest step. So that's where you're removing the majority of the glass. Each successive step should take a little less time. So Looks like most of my magic marker seems to be gone. So let's wash this off and take a look. So while my magic marker was all gone, I still think this is just a little bit rougher than I'd like it to be. So I'm gonna go a little bit further on this 220 just to get a little bit deeper on there and make my next step a little easier. I could cover this all with magic marker again, but I've still got a little wet on here. So I'm just gonna put it right down and go a little bit longer on my 220 grit. See, it's starting to get a little dry, so I'm going to get some more moisture in the middle there. As your silicon carbide starts to kind of dry out and your pieces start to get flatter and flatter, it will tend to want to suction to the glass a little bit, which can be a little interesting. So you want to make sure you have enough moisture still in here so you don't create too much of a suction. Let's check this again. You see, I'm a little bit happier with that. I still think it could go a little bit further, but I'm gonna just go ahead and move over to my 400 grit just to keep this moving along. But that's not too bad. It's looking pretty good. And we're gonna switch this now and move over to a 400 grit. So you can see I've taken my plate glass and I've cleaned a little bit of the both 60 grit and 220 grit off, and I flipped it over. Now, when you clean off your plate glass, if you're not gonna keep your silicon carbide on there, don't take it to your sink and wash all this stuff down the sink. It will start clogging up your drains. So if you're going to wash off your plate glass, try and scrape as much of the grit off and put it in the trash. Take it outside, spray this stuff off in the yard. Do not put it down your drain. It will clog up your drain lines and you'll be jackhammering your floor and hiring a plumber. Just don't do it. So if you're doing this, make sure to clean this off somewhere other than your sink. And like I said, you can use both sides of this. I just flipped this over. So this was my 60 grit. This was my 220. Now I'm going to use 400 on this. You generally want to clean up probably a little bit better than I did, just because it's so easy to cross-contaminate with silicon carbide. Since it is a loose abrasive, it kind of gets everywhere. So you want to be a little more careful. But this should be pretty good for what we're doing today. And we're going to move to a 400 grit silicon carbide now. And you can see this stuff is like toner. It is so thin that it just sticks really well. There's nothing, no granular part to it. It's just going to stick to everything. When I put some water in here, it's going to have a really hard time mixing with the water. It's going to want to clump up really badly. These situations are where you do want to find a little bit of dishwashing soap to mix in with this, just to get it to mix well and stay loose so it doesn't clump up quite so badly. So there's our 220 grit surface that we're moving from, and we're going to try a 400 grit now. And you can see it really wants to stick. Once it gets into this really fine abrasive, you've got an incredibly fine abrasive underneath here, and you've got a surface that's getting really, really flat, and it's gonna wanna stick to the flat surface underneath you. Like I said, this can be really good to do if you have some other things you want to do. Watch a show on television and just sit here and move a piece back and forth under grit. Doesn't even have to be. You could do circles. You could do figure eights. You could do just about anything you want to, as long as you've got a randomized movement under there that's keeping the loose abrasive underneath it. And again, I keep changing my hand position on there just because I'm putting pressure in one particular place. You could use both hands if you wanted to on it to give more pressure on it to go a little bit faster. I'm trying to just give you a better view of what's going on today by using one hand. Let's go check this one out real quick and see how far we've gotten. So there's just a few minutes on our 400 grit, and I'm not sure how well you can see. It's really quite nice surface. It's really pretty. I don't see any real deep divots in here at all. It's very semi-translucent. If I got it wet, you know, you can almost see through it. It's really quite a nice surface. But you can see how quick and easy it is for loose grit abrasive to be a very effective cold working technique for you, depending on what your pieces are like. It's inexpensive, it's super easy, it takes a very small amount of space, and it goes relatively quickly. And you can move further on to like an 800 grit, and then move into something like a pumice step on either a flat lap or something like that, or using pumice with a hand pad, like a Scotch-Brite green pad with pumice, and work pumice by hand on this. So you can do a lot of your cold working without machinery and with just really inexpensive loose abrasives, and it works really quite well.